I'm Al McFarlane. Welcome to Conversations with Al McFarlane, broadcasting from the Marcus Garvey House here in North Minneapolis. And you know, it's all about the neighborhood. This is a conversation about how we build our community, our neighborhood, house by house, family by family. We're focusing on business creation, business development, economic development, and culture. It's a wonderful conversation, a robust conversation. One of the guides for this conversation is my brother, who takes us on a musical journey, Wayne McFarlane and jazz. Check him out. I'm Al McFarlane. Welcome to Conversations with Al McFarlane. Glad to have you here. Glad to have you listening on KFAI and watching across public access television in St. Paul and Minneapolis. Our topic today is healthcare. The country is not clear at the moment on what the future of the Obamacare will be. The Republicans are saying repeal and replace. That discussion is happening around the country. The Democrats want to figure out how to make sure we don't lose health care coverage for 20 million people who've been at it. I want to bring that conversation to our local community here. I'm pleased to have a person on the front line of providing health care to people in communities of color. Clarence Jones is the Director of Outreach for the Southside Medical Organization in South Minneapolis. Clarence, good morning.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you for being here. And joining me is Twila Brase. She is an organizer. She is the founder, I believe, and president of an advocacy organization that supports the work of patients and freedom. The organization is the Citizens Council for Health Freedom, and it's a national organization based here in St. Paul, and it tries to explain and promote change in healthcare, change that's based on the notion that people should have choices and should have freedom. We'll ask you to unpack that and tell us what it means in a minute. And I'm also joined today by a colleague serving as co-host today, Rick Aguilar. Rick Aguilar is the president of Aguilar Productions. He's a colleague. He's the publisher of Latino American Today. Rick, good morning.
Good morning, Al.
Good to see you.
Pleasure to be here.
Well, thank you for working with me to help this conversation go forward. So let me start with background. Clarence Jones, talk about what the work of Southside Medical is, how that work changed with the introduction of what we call Obamacare, and what's at stake right now from the ground level from your point of view.
Southside started in 1971 with as a community clinic. And in that period of time, its focus has always been on making sure that the community had access to medical care. And so we have been doing that since 1971 for over 40 years. About 15 years ago, we started a outreach department which really focused more on public health, which meant that we were very concerned about people not only having health care, but also having access to care. One of the things that we have discovered, or one of the things that has really enhanced our work, has been the creation of the Affordable Care Act, which allowed us to provide more services to people. And so we now have health navigators. We have interest in terms of we're involved in the community in terms of medical access. And so from my perspective, I think that we're in a good place, although it's a very uncertain place in terms of being able to at least provide some kind of services to our community. So from a, I think from my particular perspective, I'm excited, I'm also concerned. We're just not, to me, it just doesn't make sense to just throw 20 million people off of medical services, so.
Let's talk about the background here and the model of healthcare. I think the model we experience in the country is one of healthcare being when you're sick, go to the doctor. And not so much being proactive and preventive. That's changing now. I think the discussion in the country is about how do you get people to think about health and to live ways that are more healthy, that are health sustaining, and that are illness preventing. So we come from a place where we would go to the doctor when we were sick, go to the hospital when we were sick, and we needed insurance to do that, or we paid these bills. And sometimes the bills were horrendous. And for that reason, many people of color, many poor people were left out of the system. Either they chose to not have the care they needed, or couldn't get the care they needed, or they went to the public resource, public hospitals, to get care at a great expense to the taxpayer. And so the premise of Obamacare, as I understand it, is that if enough people enroll in paying for service, the cost for all of us being insured would be reduced. That might or might not have been realized, but that was the model, I think. Is that correct?
You know, that's, and I think that you made some excellent observation about how healthcare has been utilized in this country. And that's one of the reasons why we went to more of a public health model, which is to talk more about the preventative portion of that. And so I do believe that the Obamacare was designed to get more people in, and that really, to me, was the important part of the addition to our work, is that there was now a recognition that we needed to look more at getting people engaged before they were sick in terms of health care and providing them with medical access.
So the challenges included this idea that in the black community,
sure,
there was criticism internally about how we tend to over-rely on the emergency room.
Sure.
For whatever reasons, we have not gone in to do the prevention, or we've not been accustomed to being the planful in our lifestyle in ways that would reduce dependency on the emergency room. Or we were fearful that the medical institution wouldn't serve us, so we put off going to get even preventive care, right? And so part of it's about education and access, and that seemed to be turning a corner. But we still have these great, huge health disparities in our community. Talk about that.
And once again, I think that's you're making some very, very excellent points, because I think that part of what we recognized was the fact that we had to do more community education. When I look at some of the issues in our community, and I may get in trouble for saying this, I think that us, communities of color, health professionals, needed to be much more engaged in terms of, you know, letting our people know about what some of the services are. And so, to me, it is, we have to turn this corner, we have to be more engaged, we have to create more, community health workers, those kinds of things, in order for us to be able to make sure that our community stays healthier.
So, Rick, as a publisher and an observer of the community, what's the story from your point of view? What have you observed as a business owner, as a parent, as a communicator describing what the challenges and needs are? How does where we stand now look to you?
Well, you know, beside our Latino American today, you know, we have our Aguilar Productions, and then we 21 years now promoting the multicultural markets to corporate America. And a year ago, I attended an interesting meeting that was put together by the Department of Health. And it was shortly after that I think there was a kind of a shakeup in the medical health organizations, with a lot of confusion about who was going to be providing these informations to our people of color. And at that meeting, I was sitting thinking that, you know, this reminded me of corporate America 20 years ago when we started producing multicultural marketing conferences. They didn't know how to put the message out of their products and services to the community. They were confused. Their lives in corporate America were marketing to the general market, and they had that message. Well, that message wasn't resonating in the multicultural markets. And I found myself thinking, I think it's time to produce a health and wellness national marketing conference, because there was confusion there. And we went around and did that. And I'm glad we did, because some of the things you're talking about here, Al and Twila and Clarence, are, you know, health is like anything else. You have to market it. You have to give them the right message why they should do the wellness. If you give them the general market message, that's not the same as you're going to talk to African Americans and Latino men who are proud men about going to get a colonoscopy. You better make sure that message is right. Same thing with prostate. You know, those are diseases, unfortunately, that affect men in a way that is very intimidating. So we did produce the conference, big success. It proved the point that there is a lot of confusion. And I think it's with same thing with Clarence is talking about, providing more community people, doing more outreach. in Twila with her trying to work with the public. But in the sense, but in the end, it's all about marketing. So that's where I'm at today. We need to learn more how to get our message out there effectively with our budgets, so that, you know, as we're spending these dollars, are we getting that return? But I'm as always, Al, I'm glad you're having this discussion, because this is we're at a tipping point here in the country, I think, with where
well,
we're
at. Bring Twila in. Yeah. Twila, you're an RN, so you've got hands-on experience, and you're an organizer, and you're leading a national movement, and the core idea, as I understand it, is being an advocate for individual patient freedom, patients' rights. And so you have not been a supporter of what we call Obamacare, and you have been an advocate, and you, I think, are applauding the future. So let me ask you, why did the Obamacare model not work for you? What were the problems? And what do you see this administration moving towards? What are you supporting?
So I think I'll just say first that I am a registered nurse and I am an ER nurse. And, you know, I don't ever remember in all my time in the ER ever looking at anybody according to their color, their race, or anything. And so it all just had to do with the patient. So from our perspective, you know, we look at if we have a healthcare system. If the healthcare system, the only reason we have a healthcare system is because we have a patient. If we didn't have a patient, there'd be absolutely no need for a doctor or a nurse or a hospital, nothing, right? So you have to go, when you think about what's happening in healthcare, you have to think about the primary purpose for healthcare, which is that there is a patient, and then that the patient is vulnerable. Even the patient who has an ear infection is vulnerable because they can't get what they need without the doctor. So no matter what, every patient is vulnerable just by nature of being a patient. So if you think about the ethics in the system and how you have to have, like, if you were the doctor and I was the patient, you'd have to be somebody that I would trust, because I have no, you know, I have no power on my own to get what I need. And I really need you to be that trusting person, trustworthy person. And I need you to hear what I'm saying so that you actually give me the right diagnosis and you actually figure out what the problem is and can provide it to me. So when I look at Obamacare, a lot of people think Obamacare is just about the exchanges, the penalties, the mandates, the insurance, you know, the deductibles, the copays, right? That's all they think about. But Obamacare is a 2,700-page bill. 700 pages of that were for the IRS changes. But so many parts of Obamacare are really about the federal government taking over the practice of medicine. So there is, of course, the insurance piece, and there is the exchanges, and there is all the cost of all of that, which increase the price of coverage and increase the price of care. But there's also what people don't talk about, which is how much the government is going to be and is being involved in what happens in the exam room as a result of that. And our organization really is all about patient choices, individualized patient care, and medical and genetic privacy rights, because we know he who holds the data makes the rules. And what Obamacare did was I think a lot of people don't know this, it abolished catastrophic coverage for anyone over the age of 29. So
explain that.
Yeah, so catastrophic coverage is like indemnity insurance, or so you've got a house and you have fire insurance or homeowner's insurance, right? And that is for when the house is burning down or the flood comes, right, and just demolishes the house, the tornado comes, right? And that was the kind of coverage that 6 million people had before Obamacare that was stripped away from them, because Obamacare says you can't have real coverage, real insurance for the catastrophe. Insurance is really about protecting you against the financial catastrophe in life. So when you get the coma, the car crash, the cancer, right? Then all of those things are financial, can be financial disasters, and that's what true insurance is for. But that insurance was prohibited by law, except if you're under 29 and under. And so what Obamacare did was it handed over the entire healthcare system to the managed care corporations, whose whole plan is to profit off of the patient and the doctor, making it much more difficult for the patient and the doctor to have the necessary patient-doctor relationship, the time, the attention that the patient needs, and really putting much more requirements in the practice to do things that are not really about patient care. So I hear from patients that they now see the top of the head of the doctor, because he's like this, right, in front of them. Or they see his back. Or they ask a question and the doctor says, I can't answer that now, but you can make another appointment. You know, or they don't even get to see the doctor. They see somebody who's not a doctor, and what they really wanted was a doctor. And so we have really put so much bureaucracy and overhead and box checking and the mandate for the electronic health record. And so all of their data is not even confidential anymore because HIPAA doesn't protect their privacy. It took away their privacy. This is all not what the healthcare system was about. It was about the patient and the doctor who was going to help the patient to take care of themselves at an affordable price. And Obamacare has increased the cost. And other bills, other laws, including Medicare, that have increased the cost because they require all of this reporting, all of this bureaucracy, all of this box checking, all of this mother may I medicine, right? Can I do this or can't I? And so we've sort of perverted the healthcare system from the patient and the doctor.
I'm going to ask you and I'm going to ask Clarence, are we better off or worse off because of Obamacare? Are we worse off in the future if we dismantle this and go back to letting the market and people get what they want when they want it? Did what we have before work? That's the question. I think it did not, but you can argue that with me. I'm Al McFarlane. This is Conversations with Al McFarlane. We'll be back in just a minute. Come back. I'm Al McFarlane. Welcome back to Conversations with Al McFarlane. The topic is healthcare. We're looking at efforts to remove or replace Obamacare. The question is what the future will be. And I want to go back with my guest today and sort of unpack some of the issues here. Clarence Jones is the outreach director for Southside Medical. And Clarence, you and I go back a long way talking about how our communities experience health.
Sure.
From my point of view, certainly, maybe it's yours as well, there's this idea that we haven't been fully and properly served by the medical and health establishment, that there has been a duplicity, on the one hand, a willingness to blame our community for failing to either live right or do right or access resources that are there to help us be more healthy and more productive. That's one side of it. On the other hand, there's our experience of rejection and fear and distrust of what the system has done to us and how it has not served us in the past. Therefore, you have this huge disparity in health outcomes. Our people rank highest in heart failure, in obesity, in things like hypertension, and there are other areas where we out-index the population. And there's a problem that we want to address. The initiative now is how to reduce this discrepancy, this disparity in health outcomes for our people and the general population. Is that a fair description of it? And so how does it look to you? Was what we had before working, meaning were the disparities that we experienced acceptable?
You know, another excellent question. I want to go back to the point where you talked about the fact that we experienced a lot of rejection going into the working with the medical profession. I really wish that people would see us as individuals. Unfortunately, when I take a look at the statistics and look at all the reports and things like that, we know that that's not true. People don't necessarily see communities just as the general public, as you talk about. And so I think that one of the concerns that I have is that it would be nice, but I don't necessarily think that's the reality of what we've experienced in the real world in terms of the medical field. Was it better in the past? I don't think so. I think for me, from where I sit, I find more people now who are more engaged in terms of their health and in their care. I think we still have huge disparities, but I think that now with the national conversation, it has made people more aware of their responsibilities towards being healthier, not only for themselves, but also for their communities. So, you know, whether Obamacare, whatever we may say about Obamacare, from my perspective, I believe that we're now having more honest conversations about how do we address these issues. And now we are starting to actually have more programs to help people to find their entry point into this conversation, which I think in the past, it was, you know, as you said before, we were just victims. But now we actually have some places where we can enter in and begin to make some changes for our children and for ourselves.
Twila, same question to you. You described this passion for ensuring the rights and the freedom of the consumer. And that's a great idea. It's a wonderful model. It's as wonderful as the notion of the founding of the country, the idea that all men and women are free and have an equal right to prosperity and peace, et cetera. But the reality has been different, and we know that this country, while it on the one hand professed freedom for all, engaged in enslavement of a considerable part of its population. I don't think the disparities are divorced from that. This is a legacy of a history of inequality, inequity. And so we've got a long way to go to fully engage all of our populations. The question I asked Clarence Jones was what we had before okay? And, you know, the question behind the question, the proposition is that it was not okay. Mm-hmm. It wasn't okay for black people. And so, is there, in your experience or mind, a model that did work that you think has been either corrupted or derailed or somehow damaged by the government overreach? Mm-hmm. And I think that many of the conservatives would say that Obamacare is an instance of government overreaching into the relationship between the patient and the doctor. Mm-hmm. And so describe for me, if you could, when the system, that model, fully and properly functioned. Or did it, you know, if it did.
Right, so we've had a long history of healthcare in this country. And we've had a long history before Medicare and before managed care where prices were actually affordable, where you could find very, you know, small hospital bills where people had their children paid cash, like the Amish do today. They negotiate with their doctors and they pay cash for care. And so when I look at what has happened with healthcare, I look at the fact that we brought additional costs in, unnecessary costs in, unnecessary intrusion. When we started first with the employer sponsored coverage, which then grouped people into groups, captive groups, right? And then so Medicare came along and 19 million people got Medicare without having paid a dime into it, which is why some people have called it a Ponzi scheme, right? Because now we're going to have 80 million people in Medicare and the labor force is shrinking and they're all supposed to support all these people in Medicare. And all we're seeing is rationing. Rationing is on the way in the Medicare program. And so in order to stop the rationing, Ted Kennedy and Richard Nixon got together and did the HMO Act of 1973. And they forced employers with 25 employees or more to offer the HMO, and they gave $375 million to build it up. This was a completely, you know, experimental system. But what it really said was that outsiders would come in, they would merge the delivery and the financing of healthcare together in a conflict of interest with the patient. And so now we have managed care across the entire country, and we don't have true insurance anymore. We don't have pocketbook prices anymore because everybody runs every expense through the insurance company. So from our organization, what we had before Obamacare did not work. But we at least didn't have managed care into everything. At least we had the opportunity for a truly affordable catastrophic policy. So from the perspective of our organization, whatever happens with Obamacare, and by the way, I just disagree that 20 million people will be off the street. And I've actually done an article in the Daily Caller talking about how the majority of the Medicaid population were actually eligible before, but they hadn't chosen to do it until the mandate, right? And the pre-existing people with pre-existing conditions, most of them were covered by the high-risk pools in the states. And there's the 6 million people that had insurance before Obamacare but got kicked off, and all they had left was the exchange. So there's a lot of people in that 20 million that would be covered again as soon as we got rid of what we have. But from our perspective, we need something very different. We want to go back to before managed care and before Medicare. We want to go back to where the patient and the doctor have a relationship, the patient has a relationship with the hospital, the patient has a relationship with their insurer. So we developed what was called, and there's no interference. There's no interference, and there's not all this overhead that's costing money.
How is there guaranteed access to the patient? Here's the reason I asked the question. In our family history from down south, there's stories about where a black woman pregnant going to a doctor to have a baby, doctor comes to his house and delivers the baby on the hood of a car. This is a case where the doctor's office may have been in the house. Because the doctor is white, the woman's black. The doctor didn't feel like this patient deserved to be in his practice, his home. So the question of race culture is an overlay that affects me. And so the question is, how do you address ensuring that every human being has access to every medical consideration, and not a situation where the market simply allows those who are organized or wealthy enough or who are perceived to be a model or preferable customers get the chance to live and others get a chance to die. That was the story before from my point of view. What do you think?
Well, I realize that racism is an issue, right? But I don't know that it's the same issue that it was way back when. I mean, because truly, I did not look at people coming into the ER. I did not look at them on their color. I looked at them, were they crying? Were they dying? You know, what was happening to them, right? So I just don't feel like it is back like it was. And so, you know, from our perspective, we want everybody, we don't believe in a right to health care, because as soon as you have a right to health care, you enslave the doctor and say, your services are mine.
So that, absent a right to health care means what?
Absent a right to health care means we have a 5C solution for health care. So just, we have cash for care, catastrophic coverage, which is the affordable kind, charity for the truly needy. There's even charity in Canada, right? And then we have confidentiality, because we believe confidentiality is important for every person to know it's a safe, trusted place in the doctor's office. And then compassionate care. And compassionate care is going out the window today, because the doctors are looking at everything that every outsider tells them they have to do for the patient. They're not actually looking at the patient and saying, I feel concerned for you. I have time to take care of you. No, I don't have time to see you because I have all this other stuff that I have to do. And so what we really need is a system that is affordable, which is why we started the Wedge of Health Freedom. Jointhewedge.com. Okay. Jointhewedge.com. We've got 200 practices, almost 200 practices across the country. Cash, check, or charge, and if they want, some of them do charity. And so they make the prices at the pocketbook level. So it's very much like in Tennessee. There's the Patmos Clinic in Tennessee. Pay at the moment of service, right? Patmos Clinic. Mm-hmm. And he sees people from all over Tennessee. He's got Medicaid patients that come to and pay cash, check, or charge for him, and he does some bartering for them, right? Mm-hmm. They'll you know, paint his clinic, right? Mm-hmm. And he negotiates prices with the nearby X-ray facilities and lab facilities and hospitals, all for these people, and it's affordable.
Clarence, how different is that from what you're doing right now? What it sounds like is an approach that tries to get people a variety of ways to get what they need, and I don't think that's a lot different from what clinics like Southside do for the community, is it?
No, it isn't. I mean, I think what we would try to do is, we are a clinic where anyone can come and access our services. I mean, we have medical.
The difference is anyone. And
anyone.
That's not cash.
Right.
What's the acronym?
Cash, check, charge.
Right.
So, or charity.
Right.
Okay.
And so, yeah, I mean, so anyone can have access to that. I mean, there are co-pays that people have to pay. And, you know, and so we cannot turn anybody away. I mean, that's one of the things about the federally qualified clinic.
So would you call that enslaving the profession? Well, if they can't turn somebody away?
They can't turn somebody away, but they have choices as to whether or not they're going to work for that clinic.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So if you choose to work for that clinic, this is the situation you choose to work in.
Okay. Go ahead, Clara.
I'm trying to track with that. if you choose work for that clinic, what do you mean?
For your clinic? There are doctors at your clinic?
Sure, they can choose to work there.
Right.
Yeah.
So the question I raised was her comment about the fact that people have to be served. You can't turn anybody away. Does that process enslave the profession and not give the professional the choices he or she would like in serving who he chooses to serve, right?
Well, we don't have a right to health care today. Mm-hmm. And even if we had a right to health care, I would like to just sort of convince people that that wouldn't actually be a very good idea, because individuals have a right to not be a doctor. And if you have a right to health care and you have a right to tell them that you have to serve me, they have a right to either go away and find something else where they're not, you know, where they're treated differently, right? Mm-hmm. And what we really want in this country is care. Cover, you know, we got a lot of people covered who don't necessarily have access to care, and or who have access to some care, or have access to only care in this hospital, when what they really need is a specialist in this hospital, but it's not in their network, and so they can't get that person. So the important thing is to realize that coverage does not equal care, and what you really want is a joyful doctor who's really pleased at the profession, who doesn't become burnt out from all of the bureaucracy and the paperwork, who has a patient who, if they give them free services, is actually grateful, as opposed to, you know, I'm entitled to your service and I don't really care. And I will make an appointment with you and then I just won't come because, you know, this is an entitlement. So what we really need is just really a much more caring, compassionate society, and where charity is actually valued. I think that's really a problem, that people think that charity should be like dismissed, and instead we should do Medicaid, where the doctors aren't even paid really enough to do the paperwork, right? And so that's a more of a coercive system than charity. I've had specialists tell me they'd prefer to do charity rather than Medicaid because, one, there's a gratefulness on the part of the patient and they're giving their services for free, and two, there's no paperwork. And so, you know, I think we can have a much more compassionate, much more affordable healthcare system without continuing to just pile on the government, which just adds more and more paperwork and takes away the joy of the practice, and then doctors just disappear.
I'm Al McFarlane. This is Conversations with Al McFarlane. My guest, the voice of Twila Brase. She is an RN and also an emergency room nurse, but she's the founder and organizer of Citizens Council for Health Freedom, CCHF. We'll give you her contact information. And Clarence Jones, he's the Director of Outreach for Southside Medical. My co-host today is Rick Aguilar. Rick Aguilar is the chairman of Minnesota Multicultural Media Consortium. He is the editor and publisher of Latino American Today and president of Aguilar Productions. We'll come back in a minute. I'm Al McFarlane. Welcome back to Conversations with Al McFarlane. Continue my conversation with Twila Brase. She is an RN, a emergency room nurse, but also the president and co-founder of the Citizens Council for Health Freedom. My co-host today is Rick Aguilar, a fellow publisher, leader in ethnic media. He's the chairman of the Minnesota Multicultural Media Consortium. He's the owner and publisher of Latino American Today and produces health fairs and health conferences, marketing conferences, through Aguilar Productions. Rick, yeah, you started off talking about how important it is that we elevate the conversation. We need to create more awareness, more marketing that both educates and invites involvement and utilization of both knowledge and resources by our communities. What do you think?
Well, I thought at our conference we had last year, again, we produced this health and wellness multicultural marketing conference. We found out that, you know, different communities think differently about health. They have their own remedies they're going to go to first. You can do all the marketing you want, but when that Asian person or Latino feels something, You know, they're going to say, well, first of all, I'm going to go back to what grandma did. See, so they're going to go that shot, see, because that's still there. That's still ingrained. Why? Because we're still getting all these new immigrants. This is first generation. I was born and raised here, so I'm beyond that, and I'm going to the doctor. See, but you know, some of our immigrant friends are going to try that remedy first. They're going to make that tea, or they're going to. So we have to understand that, and that's why these marketing things are important. That's part of marketing. How do you reach these people? So once you can understand that, you might better understand a patient that comes in. An immigrant patient that hasn't had that treatment, you might be thinking, the doctor, well, why haven't you ever called us? You had this symptom and that. And that's where we're at today. But I think what's striking about this conversation here, and it's an excellent conversation, is going back to where we are with doctors. You know, people aren't practicing medicine anymore. That talented student is making choices. Now he's seeing dwindling dollars in being a doctor. He's seeing the bookkeeping now, all that you have to go through, and then he's seeing what it costs to become a doctor, and they're taking all that in consideration. So we're going to probably be looking at a whole generation of doctors from other countries, which we're getting now. And you know, when they arrive here, they've got to start understanding the Latino. They've got to understand the Asian. So we're going to be going through a whole nother, you know, when in fact, we haven't got our professional doctor, that whole profession, understanding who we are now. So I think the more we can talk, the more we can have these open conversations, and the more that we can market our services to and make sure that these people understand it. We care about them as part of the marketing. Marketing is all about the heart. So I think we'll be more successful, but yeah, we're in for some challenging times.
Clarence, jump in here. You know, the model, again, for Southside Medical, I think, comes out of the Great Society of the war on poverty.
Right, exactly.
And the experience in community life back then was an experience for at least black people of exclusion and of oppression, an experience of second class status in every element from economics to health to education, et cetera. And by virtue of the ongoing and successful work of the civil rights pioneers who demanded this nation begin to live up to its creed that all men are created equal, right, and deserve the opportunity to or express their inalienable rights to freedom and the pursuit of happiness, then how does that look in public service, in transportation? How does it look in education? How does it look in healthcare access, healthcare outcomes? And so we begin watching and looking and moving and challenging. And part of that led to the creation of new opportunities like Southside Medical,
exactly.
Like North Point Health and Wellness in North Minneapolis, and like Open Cities in St. Paul. So your industry of community-based healthcare outreach and service was a product of the civil rights movement. So take it from there. Yeah. And so why is it important that we find ways to make the initiatives that you represent more effective and expand to deliver more value to the consumer, the community?
Yeah, I think we've said the word compassionate, you know, a couple times here in terms of what we need to be providing for our communities. And I think that one of the things that we find in those particular clinics is more of a sensitivity towards compassion, more of a sensitivity towards allowing people to really understand and have access to doctors, those kinds of things. Unfortunately, we are in a place where we need to be more intentional in terms of making those kinds of things happen. But I do believe that that there is a real understanding, there is a real need where we have to have this conversation where we begin to understand that we are dealing with a long history of people who have been deprived of these things. We are looking at people and we're saying that that they're responsible totally for their condition. And I'm saying that we have to become, at least for me, this is my own personal, I think we have to have much more of a public health model in terms of how we deal with our community, giving people, providing people with access, but as Rick said, also making sure that they have education and access. And so where we at right now, we're at a, really at a crucial crossroad, you know, because we have this conversation about taking away access. And whether people mean it or not, the conversation creates stress in our communities. It creates undue tension in our communities. And so people like myself who have to deal with the community, we have to figure out ways, how do we alleviate that stress in terms of letting people know that we're going to be here and that we're going to provide services for them in spite of what else is going on. So where we're at right now, I think that we're at this critical juncture that people are fearful. And that, to me, makes no sense in light of this country or what this country is supposed to represent. Compassion, you talked about equality, those kinds of things, it's really not here. But I do think, again, that as a professional, healthcare professional, we have to continuously do what we have to do in spite of what else is going on around us.
Twila, respond if you would. The question for me then is, how do we ensure that people who saw themselves as consistently and structurally excluded, how do we ensure that they get the help they need?
So, I think
there's... The service they need, yeah.
Yeah, so I think there's several things in there. Even one of the things that you mentioned is, or was it you, I cannot remember, but this idea of waiting or thinking that somebody is not going to serve them the same. I know that part of the problem that I at least hear from doctors and practitioners is just the fact of the Medicaid program itself. So if you're on the Medicaid program, right, the Medicaid program itself is just such a poor payer, right? So it's more like that program is a drag on the clinic, right? And so, but I don't know that that's how people, the doctors and the nurses, then look at the patients differently. I will say that one of the things that you mentioned was outcomes, right? And so there's an interesting thing happening, and I bet that patients don't really understand that this is happening, but doctors are being judged on the outcomes of patients. So they're being judged on whether or not their patient smokes. Now, who's responsible for whether or not their patient smokes, right? And so as one doctor said recently, my patient could have a wonderful cholesterol, a wonderful A1C, which is sugar level, right? A wonderful this and a wonderful blood pressure, but they still smoke. And so I get black marks, and I do not get as much money because my patient smokes. Am I responsible for my patient smoking? No. I mean, the doctor is not responsible for the cholesterol level. The doctor is not responsible for the blood pressure. But that's how the government is judging, and the health plans are judging the doctors.
Clarence, what do you say about that?
Well, I understand that. I understand that there's a personal responsibility that people have to have. And I do understand that there is more judgment on doctors and things of that nature. But I do. I also think, though, that there has to be more, as you talk about, there's more engagement with between the doctor and the patient in terms of what they need to do for their health. But I do want to go back to one point. This is America. The color of America is green, okay? And so a lot of the conversations that we're having really is about it is about money, you know? And so I think that part of what we have to acknowledge is the fact that we're going to have these difficult conversations because people are still looking at how much green they're gonna be able to make. And so I think for us, in terms of community engagement, we have to help people understand how their health is worth green to them.
Is it about money to you, Twila? Is the underpinning of this conversation about money income?
No, I think there are two, there are at least three entities in healthcare where money is the underpinning. Mm-hmm. One is the health plans. One is the government just in continuing to keep their, you know, system running. And the other one are the data, the whole data industry, who now looks at us as the 21st century version of the gold mine, right? They get all our data because of HIPAA, because of the health plans, because of the government programs. They get all of this data. And so I don't think it's about money. I do know that the doctors have to be able to succeed. The clinics have to be able to succeed. And I know so many of them who would like to get rid of all the bureaucracy, which would get rid of all sorts of costs, and just have a direct patient relationship and make that succeed. They want to be free to be a doctor to their patients. They want to have the kind of ethical and conscience that they can go to sleep at night. One of the doctors who helped at the launch of the Wedge of Health Freedom, she said that 2 years out of her practice, she was in the system, right? 2 years out of her practice, she couldn't sleep at night. She said, I know I'm not taking care of my patients the way I need to take care of them. And so she began right then to chart a course to go third party free, not deal with the insurance company, not deal with government. Half of her patients are Medicare patients. They pay cash, check, or charge because she's their doctor. She goes into their home. She goes to the hospital to make sure the hospitalist or whomever is not rationing their care in the hospital. That's what every patient wants. And you see patients, Medicaid patients that go to the Patmos clinic, or there's an Ohio clinic that's fee for service, and 20% of his patients are Medicaid. And this woman who has half of her patients Medicare. The value of health and the value of having somebody really on your side who's your advocate against the insurance company, against any government rationing, is so valuable. And so when we're talking about green, right, these are doctors whose biggest joy is to take care of the patient, but they need a certain amount of money to survive. But we also look at the patient who says, a certain amount of green, this is valuable to me, and I'm going to, you know, not do something else so I can have this kind of a relationship.
So I think that money does matter. It does. And I've said often, Twila, that too often in this country, we get the misery and others get the money. Mm-hmm. And so the question for me is, how do we monetize both the opportunity that our healthcare represents in a way that benefits both the providers, the doctors, mm-hmm. the nurses, facilities, the support systems. How do we look differently at this entire equation that goes into making our community healthy? Look at the advantages that flow from our perpetual disparity, mm-hmm. or the advantages that may flow from shifting the model to a model where, as a community, we become is it a green community or a blue community, mm-hmm. One whose attitude towards health and living properly engages in the eradication of the disparity, but also the creation of a stellar experience, mm-hmm. of healthfulness in our community. How do we change that entire model? I think that government has a role to play, mm-hmm. but it has to be one that's driven by and supporting resources, players, thinkers, mm-hmm. And patients, and servers in our community. What do you think about that?
Well, that was a lot in a little bit. I think.
Where's he going with this? Yeah.
And I just have to say that I think that there's a whole bunch of outsiders eating off the patient and the doctor. Mm-hmm. Eating off the patient and the doctor. And I think that we could really have everybody have a whole lot more affordable, confidential, simple access to care without. You know, without all the difficulties that we're having today, when we're supposedly trying to solve the healthcare system, we have only gotten into more problems. Higher costs, higher deductibles, higher premiums, inaccessible, and then a mandate to boot that you have to buy this thing that then you can't even afford to pay for it or to pay for the care that you have to get before it kicks in, right? And so I just think that that the whole healthcare system has to go back to simplicity. And I think the ethics and the professionalism should be there. I mean, I know there have been wrongs in our country, but, you know, I don't see our country back in the 1940s, 50s, 60s.
We're going forward.
Yeah, we're going forward. And you know, so many, there's now, it's almost, the colors of our people are blending themselves, right? And so, you know, I don't know what tomorrow is, but I do know that if there will always be a patient and they will be of every color.
So let me ask you a question. I want to give you the opportunity to speak on behalf of, of the conservative point of view. Mm. And you've got comments, I'm sure, on the new administration's intent to reform and change healthcare. Explain it. I want to give you the opportunity to say what's important to you.
So, I may be of a conservative mindset, but that does not mean all the conservatives think the same thing. Mm-hmm. And so, from our perspective, we want to do a repeal, mm-hmm. and any kind of replace is about taking it back to the states. Because we believe actually that you could have a Medicaid block grant that goes back to the states and that could actually serve more people under Medicaid than today, because the state could decide to take managed care out of the middle and could directly pay the doctors, directly pay the hospitals, and get managed care and all its money grabbing out of the middle. So from my perspective, it's about repealing it to get back to some part of freedom, but then it's got to go a whole lot further, and we really want it to be under state and individual control.
Clarence, does that work for you?
I don't think so. I think that, I don't have the answer. But I don't think giving money or block grants to the states is going to work. I still think you're going to have those issues plus, you know, that will still continue because you still got to figure out a way to distribute it. So one way or another, there's going to be some kind of distribution being done. So, no, I am not necessarily in favor of state blocks.
We're out of time, but Rick, last word to you. It's about marketing from my point of view and your point of view.
It's marketing, and now this healthcare is a political football now, more than ever. Mm-hmm. It was always a conversation. The politician would say, well, we got to get better healthcare. Now it's a political football.
Well, the main thing now, I think, is that we need you, the consumer, to be involved. You've got to voice your preference, your point of view, demand that your voice be heard, pursue your own health. And I think, Twila, you want to have every consumer be able to get the care that he or she wants with the relationship with his or her doctor that suits him or her best. We want your voice. We want you to know that this conversation will continue. We want to have you in it. Stay tuned for future conversations on health in our community. I'm Al McFarlane. Thanks to Twila Brase. Thanks to Clarence Jones and Rick Aguilar. We'll continue in the future. Thanks, guys.
Thank you.
All right, boy.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. We got to say good night. We want to thank Al McFarlane for bringing us all those great words and all our lovely guests, all the guests in the house. Everything's good, you know. So I want y'all to tune in every Tuesday morning, right around 9 o'clock. Because we're going to play a song. All the guests will be home. We'll be feeling like talking. Have a robust conversation. Because this thing is safe. The message is clear. Everybody knows we got to keep it light.